Hello, everyone. Today on The Final Bar, I'm joined by Denise Chisholm, one of my former colleagues from Fidelity Investments in Boston. She's the sector strategist there, has some really good thoughts about one particular sector that we've talked often about, consumer discretionary, and what we might want to expect from that sector going forward. Overall, the S&P bouncing going into the close with a nice reaction yesterday. Had a lot of distribution going into the closing minutes. Here, the opposite, a bit more communication led by the energy sector. Ladies and gentlemen, this is The Final Bar. Hello, everyone. Welcome to today's edition of The Final Bar. I'm your host, Dave Keller. I'm the chief market strategist here at StockCharts.com in a sunny Redmond, Washington. Thanks for joining us every weekday after the close as we focus on the activity in the markets using the toolkit of the technical analysts, the tools of technical analysis, behavioral finance, data visualization to try to make sense of the market dynamics and all the market participants, where they're voting with their capital. And on a day like today, we're actually going to focus a little bit on investor sentiment. A little later, we'll do a segment called Getting Sentimental. We'll focus on some of the survey data, things like the VIX put call ratios, and try to check in on where those are at relative to some of the long-term trends. And as we've talked about in recent days and recent weeks, if not recent months, the uptrend persists, right? We continue to see a pattern of higher highs and higher lows. One of my former mentors used to always say, The most bullish thing the market can do is go up. So as we continue to see this pattern of higher highs and higher lows until proven otherwise, the path of least resistance appears to be higher. So it's all about making sure that you stick with those charts that are winning. Make sure this is the right time to be considering the potential downside and focusing on what lines in the sand, what levels at which you would think about reconsidering those positions. We have great guests on the show. As always, I'm really excited to talk to Denise Chisholm today from Fidelity Investments. Coming up next week, we have the market holiday, so we have Monday off for Labor Day. Hope everyone has a great long weekend. On Wednesday of next week, on the 8th, we have Ryan Dietrich from LPL Financial. On Thursday, September 9th, Todd Sohn from Strategus in New York. And then coming up the week after, on September 14th, we have Louis Giannis from WealthNet Investments. So some great guests to help us try to make sense of this overall market activity. Let's continue on to go to today's market recap. So as I mentioned, a bit of a swing higher into the close, which is a bit different from yesterday. As always, let's not draw too much conclusion from the last hour of trading. Let's focus as much as we can on the long-term trends. And on a day like today, when we continue to push higher, certainly continues to indicate the overall strength in stocks. Today was a little different where you saw some of the cyclical sectors start to rotate back to the upside, and energy in particular, which has been one of the laggards in recent days, actually bouncing back to the upside with the XLE up 2.5%. The S&P finishing up about 0.25% higher, mid caps and small caps about 0.5%. So outperforming large caps. The NASDAQ 100, actually one of the few major indexes down today, but just a hair below the zero level, and the VIX is back just above 16:30 or so. Looking at some of their asset classes very quickly, interest rates coming off a bit with the 10-year yield remaining below 1.3%. The TLT, which we often use for bond prices, up about 0.4%. The dollar index down a little bit, but really the dollar has really been more about a sideways sort of congestion area. You had that big run higher in the dollar earlier in the year. We've sort of consolidated in that range, really have not move materially higher from there. Gold very much in the in a similar bucket from that. The GLD down about 0.25%. The chart of the GLD, okay, it's not bad, but when you're in an environment where some of the charts really overall are showing signs of strength, you're not really getting that upside follow through from the GLD just yet. Silver as well, so precious metals as a whole down, but the commodity complex finishing a little bit higher. Looking at cryptocurrencies, continues to be a bit of a mixed bag here recently, although overall the path of least resistance certainly appears to be higher, although Bitcoin is actually bumping right around 50,000. And you may laugh thinking about the importance of big round numbers, but that is not just a thing that traders talk about. It's legitimately, I've seen academic research where they talk about the concentration of orders around big round numbers. It literally is the way that we are wired to think of things, to oversimplify and think about key price levels. And that's actually reflected in the order flow. It's reflected in the data. So when something like Bitcoin approaches 50,000 from below, I'm not surprised to see resistance there as we bump up against that key level. We've pulled back a little bit. I think getting above 50,000 would certainly be a strong breakout for something like Bitcoin. So could certainly clear the way for further upside from there, because there's not much from a technical perspective above there until you get to the upper 50s. Let's look at a chart of the S&P 500. Just think about the long-term trends. And as always, we try to do is focus on the activity today, but think as much as we can about the long-term trends and how they're evolving. So make no mistake, every month in 2021, the S&P has made a new all-time high. You can say the same for the NASDAQ 100, which continues to push higher and higher. If you had one thing, I've asked many of my recent guests what they would use to try to track this trend and identify when this trend is over. My guest yesterday, Bob Lang, talked about the 50-day moving average, which we've mentioned many, many times. The S&P has closed below its 50-day moving average. On one hand, you can count the number of times, and every one of those times, it's gone right back to the upside soon after. So overall, this consistent pattern of higher highs and higher lows is a Charles Dow Technical Analysis 101 chart going higher. And until that changes, you have to assume that the path of least resistance certainly seems to be higher. So how would that picture change? So three things I'll be looking for. Number one, a lower high, right? So we attempt to make a new all-time high and we fail to do so. Number two would be breaking to a new swing low. Instead of holding at a previous support level, we actually break below it. So currently around 4360 will be that low from mid-August. The third piece would be getting below this lagging indicator, this trailing stop, if you will, the 50-day moving average, which has continued to follow below the price movements through the course of this year. At some point, I'm told equity markets tend to correct. We've not seen that so far year to date, but it will happen at some point. The way we know that that is happening, or the way we have a strong indication that's happening, are those three things are indicated, right? A lower high, a lower low, breaking the 50-day. Until those three things happen, it would be hard to imagine the market as being in anything up, anything else than a fairly consistent uptrend. Let's quickly look at some of the sector themes that we can tease out today. So as I mentioned, energy bouncing back to the upside, industrials as well. And when you look at the chart of industrials and materials, I was writing a note to my clients for market misbehavior earlier today. And I was looking at the longer term performance of some of the cyclical sectors, particularly industrials and materials. Pretty underwhelming from a relative perspective in recent months, as industrials and materials have really lagged behind. Part of that whole discussion of the infrastructure trade, which I think over the long term could certainly, certainly there's opportunity there. Infrastructure spending could certainly, provide some fuel for those trends, but the relative strength has not really been there. It's been elsewhere. It's really been the growthy areas of the market, things like technology in good relative trends, things like communication services in decent relative trends. To be honest, some areas of consumer, which have actually held up pretty well, although it's a pretty diverse sector, to be honest with you. Very quickly, let's look on a day that's moving higher. What stocks are not moving higher? And again, this is just one day's trading. So this is just one little microcosm of the markets. But when you see the market go higher, it's always interesting to look at what's lagging. When you see everything selling off, the market's coming down, look at what's actually holding up. It can be interesting to find some outliers. Today, the worst performing group out of about 105 industry groups that we track is in the financial sector, consumer finance, down just under 2%. Internet, and this is actually a pretty big, a lot of cap there in the communication services sector. This is things like Facebook and others are in this group, down 1%. So while not a climactically negative day for stocks like Facebook and Alphabet, their long-term trends still very much in play, but you can see a bit of a mean reversion. Some of these stocks that had been leaking, like Facebook and others, coming off a bit. Some of the laggards, particularly Netflix, has been one of the worst performing FANG stocks just recently, actually started to jump up pretty good, breaking to new all-time highs or threatening new all-time highs, which is pretty encouraging. On the upside, what actually is holding up very well, heavy construction, the number one group out of the 105 that we track. You also find a number of the energy sectors in that top group. Also tobacco, and it's interesting, certain names like tobacco and others, you may not think about as much, and it's in a sector, consumer staples, which it's hard to argue from a technical perspective is anything but weak, because the average group within consumer staples is actually relatively weak. It's a pretty negative trends. However, there's some pockets of consumer staples which are actually doing pretty well. The things that come to mind going through there, Kroger, right? So food retailers, Kroger, Costco comes to mind, right? Some of these trends that have actually emerged in very much a position of strength. So if we're looking at Kroger versus the S&P 500, if you did a ratio of Kroger versus the consumer staples sector, it would be really ripping to the upside because this is a sector that's been lagging overall. And these are actually some pretty decent trends in any sector. And what I would remind you is, you know, while you want to do your due diligence and understand what Kroger's business is and, you know, why this should be a lasting trend and why it has potential further upside from a technical perspective, it's all about just following the trends. And this is a chart that is working. This is a chart that's going up and to the right. I would start there and then dig into some of the themes behind there. Costco is another one that I mentioned in a pretty decent uptrend. These are the two names that tend to come to mind as I'm thinking of the consumer staples sector, thinking of stronger technical trends. This is a stock that's been outperforming well on an absolute basis, but outperforming on a relative basis as well. When you get to some of the tobacco names, it's something like Altria. And Altria, if you look from a technical perspective, has been fairly weak. It's actually been a weaker relative name. So this is a period from March, April, May, when the cyclicals were really leading. This is when financials were making new highs there in mid-May. Then the growth trade, things like technology really took over. And during this period, Altria was actually flat. So at a six-month period of not making higher highs, just now in the last week or two, starting to rotate higher, starting to break above swing highs, and now threatening all-time highs as the relative strength starts to improve. Perhaps a chart and a group to look at. We need to take a quick break. We'll be back with my guest, Denise Chisholm. We'll see you in a minute. Hello, everyone. Welcome back to The Final Bar. I'm Dave Keller here at StockCharts.com. It's so good to have you join us every weekday live after the close for our recap of the markets from a technical perspective and focus on some of the trends, momentum, breadth, sentiment, all the indications and visualizations we've talked about many times. Couple quick comments before we get to today's guest, Denise Chisholm. First off, we would love to hear from you, particularly questions that come up as you are analyzing your own charts. Our goal is to help you use stock charts more effectively to better understand the market environment and really to apply the best practices in technical analysis and behavioral finance. You can get your questions to us one of three ways: via email, thefinalbar@stockcharts.com, via Twitter @finalbarsctv, via YouTube. Just put a comment below the video you're watching on our YouTube channel. We'd love to hear from you. Hope to answer one of your questions in our next mailbag segment on Friday's show. Also, go to StockChartsTV.com. Use your email address. You can set up a free account. Start watching all of our great content immediately from our website. Also, all of your mobile devices. Great guests like Denise Chisholm and many others. Hosts like myself and great shows like The Final Bar, special events like The Pitch and Charting the Second Half, our mid-year market outlook. All of that and more on our on-demand platform. Go to StockChartsTV.com or search on any of the app stores for StockCharts TV On Demand. I want to welcome on today's guest, Denise Chisholm. Denise is joining us for the first time from the Boston area. Denise is one of my former colleagues. She's the sector strategist at Fidelity Investments. Denise, it is awesome to see you, and thank you so much for coming on today.
Oh, anytime. Great to see you, Dave.
So we are going to talk a little bit about the consumer space. We mentioned in the recap a lot of movements, but the consumer discretionary sector is sort of an interesting one. It's a relatively diverse sector, but you know the relative performance of consumer discretionary has been a little weaker relative to others, and you've had some of the mega cap stocks like Amazon and others that have struggled at times. Start us here. How are you thinking of that space?
Yeah, my process is a little bit unique. You know it well, but it's really looking at historical probabilities of data. And you end up finding out that the market is sort of a discounting mechanism, and you can see that through the probabilities. So one of the questions that I've got with the dip in consumer sentiment we've seen, and it was definitely an extreme dip, is not necessarily a recessionary event. We saw this happen in 2005 with Hurricane Katrina, and we saw it happen in 2011 with the debt ceiling issues and the dollar downgrade. What's really interesting is that you find out, as much as we're very focused on how the consumer feels, it's only a one-way correlation into how they spend. So usually when you feel better, you spend more, but it's not always typical that when you feel worse, you spend less. And what's really interesting when we think about that as it relates to stocks is these two charts. So the important thing to remember when we're thinking through the recovery trade, and as you said, it's sort of lagged on a relative basis for the last couple of months, is whether or not this provides an opportunity. when you look at sentiment contractions, what you'll see in consumer discretionary is that bottom quartile sentiment is a much better place to be from a starting point than top quartile sentiment. And that is partly reflected in the fact that sentiment resets rather quickly with consumer spending going along with it. And the right chart shows you that there's a fairly linear relationship. So statistically, the bigger contraction you see in consumer sentiment, the more likely you should be to lean into consumer discretionary stocks. So when I think through the recovery trade, and as you said, I think that the infrastructure cycle and the reopening trade still plays out over time, this analysis shows that this might actually be an opportunity to buy into the consumer discretionary sector.
And it's interesting, one of the indicators we've talked about on the show is just thinking about how people are rotating from more offensive sectors to defensive sectors. One of the ratios we've talked about is something very simple like consumer discretionary versus consumer staples and looking at the rotation there. So are there any particular indications or particular types of names that you think would indicate that this sort of theme is playing out and that you're seeing a recovery? Is there a particular space that would make sense to you for that?
Yeah, I think that it's a good way to look at it because it does proxy recovery trades, consumer staples versus consumer discretionary. And certainly what you've seen is consumer staples lag in the recovery. And I think those defensive sectors overall are actually the risk reward is still negative, given the fact that it's very unlikely, despite the fact that you see advantageous valuation levels, that they keep up from an earnings perspective. So even if at this point in a recovery, consumer staples are as cheap as they are, and they are cheap on a relative basis, what you see is that it's no longer a tailwind. It's no longer a headwind in terms of valuation compression, but there is no tailwind in terms of relative earnings growth. So from that perspective, I think that the opportunities are still in the economically sensitive sectors and the cyclical sectors like energy, industrials, financials, and consumer discretionary.
Now, you mentioned something like energy. When I think of the energy sector, I mean, from a technical perspective, you've seen these charts start to roll over and, energy financials in particular, just, really strong performance up through April, May, and then started to roll over pretty good. So energy stocks in general have had decent pullbacks while the S&P is continuing higher. You have a sector like energy. Are you seeing things with a sector like energy or even financials, which have started to come off a little bit, that suggest some opportunity there between now and your end, or are you seeing still relative weakness from those areas?
No, I do. I think energy is one of the most intriguing sectors I actually look at. And it's because the fundamentals have shifted so dramatically from what we saw in 2014, 2015. What you saw during that time where we did have a global earnings recession was CapEx relative to sales was at all-time highs, which meant they had to spend so much money to get the oil out of the ground. What you saw was free cash flow was consistently negative. And the stocks were never cheap. And I always say there's two times in an energy investor's life where you really want to know when to overweight the stocks. One is when they're cheap across the board, which they weren't during 2014, 15, 16. They were only cheap on book and sort of asset measures, but never cheap on earnings because it was so expensive to get oil out of the ground. The second time is demand declines. And the reason why demand declines are predictive is because the stocks have a tendency to look through them with multiple appreciation. That's what you've seen so far. And energy estimates have been wrong to the tune of 30 to 40% a month consistently. So now we're at the point where we're still near rock bottom in terms of demand. And we're actually now rock bottom in terms of valuation as well, because they grew into it. And we're in a situation that we have not been in 40 years, Dave, where at the bottom of the cycle, the companies were actually generating free cash flow. So that hasn't happened since 2003, when we saw it in Freeport-McMoRan at the bottom of the mining cycle where they generated free cash flow. So I think that that shows you just how much the fundamentals of the energy sector have changed. And I do think it's an opportunity. Now, it's not for the faint of heart. This is certainly the most volatile sector in the S&P, but I think that there's a place for that in your portfolio.
I love it. And I love the discussion. I appreciate you talking about some of these different sectors and the themes to pay attention to. Denise, listen, it is so good to see you. Thank you for coming on the show today. Stay safe. Be well. We'll talk to you again soon.
Thanks so much, Dave.
That's Denise Chisholm. Denise is the sector strategist at Fidelity Investments. You can hear, hopefully, by how she's describing how she approaches these sectors, why I miss working with people like Denise. Very intelligent, and they know their stuff, and help to put some of these movements into proper perspective. I love that take on consumer discretionary in the beginning, and just looking at the simple relationship of, again, looking at the data and what are the odds of the sector outperforming given the sentiment characteristics that we've started to see. Some interesting things to keep in mind, and I love that. Energy is a good potential good opportunity, but not for the faint of heart. I feel like for so many things in the financial industry, that is the way I would probably describe them. Let's continue on with today's show with our next segment, Getting Sentimental. It's our opportunity to look at some of the weekly sentiment data. A lot of it is updated Wednesday into Thursday. It can be interesting to see patterns in price, patterns in breadth, and then confirm all of the above with patterns in sentiment. Look at how people are voting with their capital, voting with their feet, or with their mouths in survey data, and see what sort of relationships we can start to draw. We're going to look at a couple different buckets of data. We're going to start with the VIX. My guest yesterday, Bob Lang, did a really good job talking about the VIX. If you missed that, go to our on-demand platform, StockChartsTV.com. You can access yesterday's interview. But we talked in particular about the volatility conditions. And in general, one of the things we've talked about is just this general trend in lessening of volatility, right? We had a huge spike in volatility February, March of 2020. From there, the upside move was alleviated. And then you settled into a pretty elevated range for the VIX. But in general, between sort of 20 and 40, that's all changed in the last 6 months as we've broken below 20. And now what's happened is you sort of have 20, which previously was the floor in volatility and tended to line up pretty well with market tops, or at least extended bull market phases. Now we've actually rotated below there. The VIX is consistently below 20. One of the things we talked about yesterday on the show, last time we looked at the VIX, was the last number of times you've had a pullback in stocks. In general, the VIX is described as the fear index. And while I don't 100% agree with that, because it's really measuring volatility, which could mean a lot of things. It doesn't necessarily mean elevated fear, but as a simplification, I totally get it. And I guess I'm okay with it. But in general, if you look, the spikes in the VIX have coincided obviously very well with pullbacks. And these are the times when the S&P's pulled back to its 50-day moving average. So we have a consistent pattern. The S&P pulls back to its 50-day. The VIX spikes to just above 20. Those, over the last 6 months at least, have been pretty decent times to be riding in the next leg higher in stocks. As one of my mentors, Greg Morris, used to say, all new highs are bullish until the last one, right? The last, very last one, when we make the top, looking back, you wish you had really clear indications that that was the final high. So having said that, I don't mind with following that pattern until proven otherwise. I think that's a pretty safe bet. So if we would start to get a pullback, I would certainly be looking at the VIX, see if we get back up to the 20 level, because over the last 6 months, that's certainly been where volatility has topped out. Recently, the VIX has been finding a bottom around 15. So as we continue to push higher, it's interesting to see if we get any lower than that 15 level. My next chart is looking at the AAII survey. This is the American Association of Individual Investors. We have a number of different surveys we tend to track, looking at investor sentiment, investors voting bullish or bearish. This one in particular is a relatively small number of individual investors, tend to be retirees, more long-term investors. They have a weekly survey where they're asked, are you bullish, bearish, or neutral on stocks? I believe over the next 6 months is how it's phrased. And we can see that in the last couple of weeks, the bullish reading had actually been relatively low. It was at the lowest level it was for the last 8 or 9 months, just 2 weeks ago. It was actually nearing around 30% bulls. And that was the first time in a long time that bears had actually outweighed bulls. For the first time in months and months, you'd actually had more bears than bulls in the survey. That's now completely alleviated. You've seen a resumption of the bullish trend that we've seen, just above 43, a pretty similar level of bears remaining steady around 33%. So what does this tell you? So for me, the general approach is to look for when the AAII bullish reading gets above 50%. That's what I would sort of consider as a euphoric range for bullishness. That's when sort of the anecdotal last buyer has bought, everyone's all bulled up, everyone's bought. And then the question is, what can propel stocks higher from here? I think a secondary theme to pay attention to, though, is look at how the highest level that we've seen in the bullish reading for years was back here in April. We were actually similar to this in November of last year, but April was the highest level that we've seen. From there, every time the market sort of made its next push higher, in general, the trend in bullish sentiment has actually been going down. So when we talk about what I call the stealth correction, sort of this environment where the indexes are going higher, but a lot of stocks are finding a lot of trouble, depending on what's in your portfolio, you've seen 10, 20, 30% declines in some of those names. If you've been in things like energy and some other stocks that have pulled back a little bit, overall, I think the divergence of the market going higher with less and less bullish sentiment could be an interesting theme to keep paying attention to. The NAME Exposure Index, National Association of Active Investment Managers, is basically, you can say whether you're 100, 200% long, 100, 200% short, or 0% equity. And it's a way of sort of aggregating what's the average weighting to equities relative to other asset classes. You can see it's holding steady just below 100%. And it's not breaking above 100%, which again, similar to the previous chart, we have levels that I would say indicate euphoria or extreme bullishness. We're not there yet. The last time we were above 100%, as you can see, similar to the previous chart back in April, was the last time we had extreme bullishness. From there, it's been a little more muted. Now, still has been elevated at times, but not getting above 100%. If we would continue higher, if we see small caps break out, which they are threatening to do, but not really following through yet. If you see mid caps continue to push higher, if you see the advanced decline lines starting to rotate higher, indicating more of a broad participation in this bull market phase, and you see the bullish readings get into that euphoric range, the AAII bulls above 50%, the NAME exposure index above 100%, I think that could be an interesting indication that we may be at that exhaustion point. Now, we have had signs of exhaustion before, but we have not followed through, and that's worth noting in this relentless bull market phase that we've been in so far in 2021. The last chart we have time for, and then we need to wrap the show here, is looking at the put-call ratios. And overall, I would describe the put-call ratios as sort of middle of the road. When you've had markets move higher and you've had extreme drops in the put-call ratio, we saw that most recently in June and July, extreme low put-call ratios potentially indicate that there's an all-in mentality in the options market. You're really not seeing that on the broad put-call ratio, all the equity. Also, the equity-specific put-call ratio, the last time it was at an extreme low level was back here in June. We had a brief pullback, but then we continued this uptrend. At this point, I would say the put-call ratios are more neutral and not really signaling an extreme at all. So it's interesting, a lot of these sentiment readings, very few of them at an extreme bullish level or in a contrarian bullish level. A lot of them sort of middle-of-the-road bullish, and it tells you that the uptrend overall is still in a stable form. We need to wrap the show. Go to the three charts in 3 minutes. Here we go. Chart number one is looking at cap tier performance year to date. So we're starting the clock at the end of December of last year and looking at the performance of 10 different buckets. These sort of the 9 Morningstar style boxes, small, mid, and large, growth, core, and value. And then I added microcap in as a 10th group. And you may be surprised to know that the top performer year to date is indeed the microcap bucket, which is up over 27%. Here's large core, which is the S&P 500, up 22%. You can see a couple of these, particularly mid and small cap value, still outperforming the S&P 500. So while you certainly can do just fine in 2021 owning the S&P 500 and just sitting back and doing nothing else, I think there are some opportunities. And what surprised me and certainly could surprise some of you is the fact that microcaps are number one. There are opportunities there if you know how to screen for them and you know how to analyze their trends. Chart number two is a bit of a stretch here. We talked about Bitcoin recently, and it's bumping up against that 50,000 level, which I think is an important big round number. A lot of times assets will sort of find resistance or support at those key levels. So I'm not surprised that we've pulled back a little bit. But what I would like to highlight for you is the fact that cryptocurrencies are not just one thing. I think years ago, you could think of cryptocurrencies as Bitcoin, and that was it. The space is starting to diversify. And if you look at just a simple comparison of two members of that group, the Ethereum versus Bitcoin, you can see that the ratio clearly has been favoring Ethereum over the last couple months. And over the long term, you can see that the trend has definitely been favoring one versus the other. If you're thinking of this area of the market a little too simplistically, I think you're missing some of the nuances, some of the opportunities to differentiate within those asset classes. My guest Denise Chisholm mentioned, I think energy was not for the faint of heart. So if you can't handle energy, you probably can't handle cryptocurrencies either, because talk about volatility. But again, think about some of those relative trends as well. Finally, we're talking a little bit about the consumer staple sector. And I find a lot not to like from a technical perspective when a chart is going down and to the right, particularly on a relative basis. And look at the relative strength of consumer staples. It's been chart challenged for quite a while. However, I would remind you that in all of the 11 S&P sectors, even those that are struggling on a relative basis, there are usually charts that are doing just fine. And within the consumer staples sector, I would focus in any place on stocks that are making new swing highs. Kroger, Costco, some of those charts that are consistent outperformers, I think are worth a second look if you've not been there. Folks, that is our show for today. Thank you so much for joining us every weekday after the close for the Final Bar. A special thank you to Denise Chisholm from Fidelity Investments joining us from Boston, sharing her thoughts on sector rotations. For StockCharts.com in Redmond, Washington, I'm Dave Keller. Be safe. Have a great night.
Hey, Grayson Rose here with StockCharts. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed that video. If you did, consider giving it a like down below, maybe leave us a comment, and if you're new to the channel, you can subscribe at the link up above. We're gonna bring you daily content from an incredible collection of technical analysts and financial experts.